Hi, thank you for coming today to this presentation at the Southboro Council on Aging. My name is Arthur Bergeron. For those of you who haven't been here before, I am an attorney. I work at Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us at Myrick O'Connell. There are 40 in Worcester and 20 in Westboro. The other 59 do something else. I do nothing but elder law. Now, for those of you folks who have been here before, you know that typically these are presentations which are elder law presentations. They're really talking about different pieces of elder law that might directly affect you. This presentation is a little bit different from that, but it's regarding material that you really, really need to know about, and it's regarding a movement which I think is already happening in some communities, and I think it's going to be going statewide very shortly, like next month. And this is the movement toward actually helping communities become dementia friendly. What does that mean? So you've all met my friends Frank and Mary. I always talk about them. They and their children, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr., and their goal in life is to live in their house until they die and to be buried in the backyard. And that's really like the goal of every one of my clients. But the question is, what if Mary starts forgetting things and is slowing down and is trying to figure out what to do? And you know, we've often talked about that, and people often talk to me about it, because most of my clients, 90% of my clients, are talking to me either because they're worried about getting Alzheimer's, or they have it, or somebody that they know has it, typically their spouse. And when I talk about Alzheimer's, I'm really talking about it because of the symptoms: dementia, lack of memory, and eventually a lot of lack of memory, like lack of memory about how to tie your shoes or take a shower, but in early stages, just forgetfulness. And the question for so many people is, that's their greatest fear, is what happens if they get Alzheimer's? And of course, everybody's dreaded fear is they're going to end up in a nursing home, but the point is that where they really want to be is they want to be at home. They want to die and they want to be buried in the backyard. So I found myself over time doing this and saying to myself, so what is the community, what would it mean to be able to do that? To be able to not only stay home, but stay in your community, even though you're getting really forgetful. And I'm very interested in this. My mother died in a nursing home after 2 years at home, and me watching as my father and my mother, just, it was all bad, as my mother got increasingly quiet because she was afraid of embarrassing herself, and my father got increasingly upset because his wife couldn't remember. And the two of them got increasingly isolated in their own home. And boy, you've all heard this story before, and I bet you know somebody with this who was going through this. And so the question is, what would a community be like in which that wouldn't happen? And that really was that's the basis of some of this discussion. We looked around nationally at whether anybody had tried to figure this out, and we found that there actually was a program that was started about 6 years ago in Minnesota, where the state encouraged individual communities through small grants to get folks together and figure out what a plan could be and how they could implement that plan to make their community become dementia friendly. And so a group of us went out to Minnesota to see that. Myrick O'Connell, my law firm, actually paid for the trip, and I went out, and three Council on Aging directors did. One's from Marlboro, Hudson, and Northboro. And they all went out to Minnesota for a couple of days to get some training, but more importantly, to see if this was all a joke and to see whether this really had some validity to it. And I think what we all found is there was a lot of validity to this and that this had real potential. And so we all came back, we and Christine Alessandro, whom you have met here before. She is the executive director of BayPath Elder Services, which is the regional agency that covers this community, together with Marlboro, Hudson, Northboro, and a number of others. We all decided that we were going to try this. And so right now, they're going through that process in those three communities. Each of the Council on Aging directors has actually assembled a group of people to work with others to try to figure out how their community could be dementia friendly. But in the course of that, we found ourselves saying, or I find myself talking to people who say, well, that sounds nice, dementia friendly community, but what does that mean exactly? And really, there isn't a specific thing, because the goal is to have individual communities figure out. But I wanted to do something to give you a sense of what that might look like for Mary and Frank, who are living in their house. Now, what it doesn't look like is the cure. We're not talking about the cure here, you know, and a lot of people are. You listen to TV, you listen to radio, you watch TV, you're always seeing people announcing the latest discovery in a memory-solving drug. But none of that is the cure. And the Alzheimer's Association and others always talk about the fact that we're all raising money and trying to get the cure, and it may come. But probably not early enough for me. Certainly not early enough for my brother, who is 78, who has an early stage diagnosis. Or for my sister's husband. My sister is 81, her husband is 84, and they're at home, and she's the caregiver, and he's taking care of him, and he's got kind of mid-stage dementia. So the question isn't the cure. The question is, how can you live happily in your home and in your community, assuming there isn't going to be a cure before you die? And so the first thing, and I know we've talked about this here before, is first, your home certainly needs to be a safe place and a dementia-friendly place. And we actually had, I think, here a woman named Carol DiRienzo come in once to talk about that. She always refers to herself as the nurse carpenter. She and her husband will go into your home and look at your home if somebody has dementia or you're worried this could happen, and try to adapt your home. And there are a lot of adaptations. You want to make sure that the stove shuts off automatically so the house doesn't burn down, a common problem if you've got dementia. Somebody forgets to shut off the stove, and you want to make sure that if you want to prevent wandering, that there's some kind of an electronic locking system that keeps people from wandering, and you want to make sure you've cut down on clutter and done lighting and a number of other things, and that's all great. But the bottom line is, Frank and Mary don't just live in their house. Well, probably they do now. Probably right now, they're spending most of their time in their house if one of them has dementia, because they're too embarrassed to go outside. But the first place that a dementia-friendly community has to be friendly is in Frank and Mary's neighborhood. And what is that neighborhood, how does that neighborhood change in a dementia-friendly community? Well, among other things, Frank and Mary aren't as embarrassed about admitting that Mary has dementia. And therefore, they're not hiding this from the neighbors. And the neighbors aren't embarrassed about talking to them, just talking to them, so that there's been enough education around dementia awareness that the shame has gone down. Folks have been trained in the neighborhood. You know, we just did this presentation in Hudson, once again, one of the places that's doing this. And one of the speakers was Janice Long, who was the executive director of the Council on Aging there. But she was also a caregiver until last fall when her mother died with dementia in Chelmsford. And so for the previous 2 years, every day, Janice, who lives in Marlboro, would, instead of going home at night, drive to Chelmsford to stay with her mother every night for 2 years to help her stay at home, because she really wanted to be at home. And one of the things she mentioned, though, was like nobody came to visit, right? And she would see neighbors and friends of her mother, who was a very active person, say, you know, you really ought to come over. You can really come over. Oh, no, I couldn't do that. Oh, you know, your mother, she's not the same person anymore. She's not the person I knew. And what would I say to her? What would I say to her? Well, she really is the same person, except that she's a lot more forgetful. And there are a lot of things that you can say to her. Now, you want some of that training because you want to be, you know, getting used to the fact that you're not probably going to be saying constantly, oh, you remember me, don't you? Don't you remember my name, right? So you remember what you did this morning. Oh, come on, you know, there's a whole piece of normal conversation that has to change because, and that change has to occur with the caregiver, because you're not going to change the person with dementia unless you get the cure, and that's not on the table today. So you need to change the caregivers, because you can have a really wonderful conversation with somebody around, what a beautiful day. Wow, those birds are great. Look at those clouds. Look at those forsythias with the snow on them. That was a depressing picture from a few days ago. But there's a lot in the present that can be really wonderful, you know? And so the neighborhood has to change. What else has to change? Well, the police station and the people who work there need to be an integral part of a dementia-friendly community. Every one of those policemen needs to know what to say in dealing with a person who has dementia, whether they've been called to a store because somebody has been disruptive and there's been a problem, or they see somebody on the street, or they're going to the house. We just did this presentation in Martha's Vineyard, and I worked there with a, a wonderful geriatric care manager, who was just telling the story of driving down the street and on the road between Oak Bluffs and Vineyard Haven in February, and she saw a lady walking down the street. And there's the lady. She's got her big coat and her hat and her nightgown and her sneakers. And so she pulled over and saw the lady and said, "Geez, can I help you? You know, can I give you a ride?" Oh, the lady got very, very defensive. "Oh, no, I'm fine. I'm fine. I know where I'm going." She kept on walking down the street. And so my friend immediately called 911, hoping that someone would show up. And sure enough, after about 2 minutes, the cruiser was coming, but so was the bus. There's a very good bus system, actually, in Martha's Vineyard. And so the bus stopped to pick up the lady, and the lady was getting on the bus as the policeman's getting out of the cruiser. And my friend was very distressed. "Oh, this is really terrible." And then the cruiser, the policeman ran over and got into the bus, right? And so my friend was all relieved. And then the policeman got off the bus, and the bus drove away. And so my friend went over to the policeman and said, what happened? And the policeman said, oh, she didn't need any help. She was just going to Chilmark. Well, actually, the bus was going in the opposite direction. And my friend said, "But did you notice she had her nightgown on, right? And it's 40, it's February, it's like 20 degrees outside." So the police are the people kind of more than anybody, but certainly they're a group of people that really need to know. And the police department needs to be involved through programs like Safe Return. It's a major program adopted in many places. I don't know if they have it here in Southboro. A program through which, if you have dementia, you can sign up at the police department. And they get you get your name and address and a phone number and a picture. So that if the police are out and they find somebody wandering, they can match it up. So you don't have to have an ID on you for them to be able to figure out where you live. Because otherwise, if you're wandering and they find you've got a problem, they're bringing you to the police station. Imagine how traumatic that is for Mary, and she's got Alzheimer's and she was out wandering. There are other programs. There is a program which is kind of a version of those bracelets that are used for folks who are on house arrest, right? Where you can give somebody a device which is a GPS related device that sends out a signal. So if they wander, you can find them. Now, the response to that is, "Well, my husband's never going to wear a bracelet, forget about it." But there's the technology for that. It can be a little chip. It can be a little something that you put in his pocket. So that if I was talking to this one lady, and that's what she does actually also in Hudson, she just puts a thing in this guy's pocket, and if he wanders away, you can actually find him because it's always giving out a signal, right? So the police need to be involved. And there's GIS, the Geographical Information Service. Massachusetts, I believe, is the only state where all of the assessor's maps in every town are on the Geographical Information Service. So if you click to your assessor's website here in Southboro, you'll find that every parcel, including yours, and the parcel where everybody else lives, because everybody really lives someplace, right, on a particular piece of land, is on that map. So if people are willing to talk about the fact that they have dementia, then, and by the way, one of the features of a GIS system is that electronically you can get what is called a data layer, and you can just add that layer on top of this GIS of these assessor's maps, so that you could actually put down on this map where everybody lives who has dementia, if people were willing to sign up. And therefore, you could also know the neighborhoods where everybody lives. So you could, if you're the police, try to be, or the Council on Aging, try to be connecting people up so that if there's an emergency, someone's going to go to that person's house who has dementia, because otherwise you're never going to connect with them. And someone's going to be looking in on them. Similarly, if you're in the fire department, first responders have to be aware of all of this. Tell me, in Southboro, does the fire department act as the first responder, or is it just an ambulance service?
Police and then fire.
So the fire guys actually show up sometimes, and oftentimes, do they have an ambulance that they use? Yes. So oftentimes I'll ask people. So here's a trivia question: why is it that whenever there's an emergency, the ambulance shows up and the fire truck and the police truck? And you know why? The answer is that only the fire truck, only the fireman can go through the door without a warrant. The ambulance guy typically can't, Police can't, without a warrant, he's the police, right? But the fireman can go through if there's an emergency. So the question is, if you're these firemen, and you're dealing with the frequent flyers, if your fire department is like others, that's how they'll refer to them. Oh, the frequent flyers, we're always at that house, right? Well, at least half of those people have got dementia. This is the reason why they're going to the house. So how do you make sure that those first responders who are dealing with people with dementia at very high stress moments know how to deal with that? And how do you develop, ideally, the training and also, once again, this kind of map so that people know where all those folks are and are able to connect them with other services as opposed to simply showing up and knowing that the first question you ask a person who is on the floor and has had an injury and has dementia is not, what happened? Wrong question, right? So there needs to be that kind of training. Or what about if you're going to the hospital? From Southboro, you're probably going either to Metro West or you're going to Marlborough Hospital or you're going up to Worcester. So it isn't like you're going to an infinite number of hospitals. So here's the issue. You show up, so here's mom showing up with her son because she fell and she has dementia and she's going to the triage nurse. And the triage nurse is talking to her and saying, so man, what happened? Oh, nothing happened. Nothing happened, everything's fine. And the son's going, Alzheimer's, you know. But the nurse is still talking to the person because that's the drill at the hospital. You're supposed to, for confidentiality and other purposes, you're supposed to be talking to the patient, right? So isn't it crucial in a dementia-friendly community that if you're going to the hospital, that everybody in the triage system gets it, right? That they've had the training, and maybe because there are only three hospitals that everybody here goes to, that there's a list, right? So that you're actually able to start making sure you're paying attention to who has dementia. Same thing applies in the doctor's office. You know, how many places do people in Southboro go to see their primary care physician? Like one Southboro Medical, right? Maybe three or four, but not 50. There's a small number of doctors and nurses that need to be trained in this. The nurses to be spotting those dementia issues, right, and to be knowing how to respond to them, how to deal with them, especially in terms of helping people with their meds and things. The doctors, in terms of first making the dementia screening a standard part of the annual exam, of the checkup. You get checked for blood, you get checked for a bunch of other stuff. This should be in there. A lot of doctors stay away from that because they get resistance from their patients. But they need to be talking to their folks about that. They need the training. And finally, they need to know where to refer someone if there is dementia. Remember, dementia is not a disease. Dementia is a set of symptoms, right? 70% of dementia cases come from Alzheimer's, which means 30% don't. 3 out of 10 dementia cases are caused by something else. You want to know that. The classic example I give is Lewy body disease. Who knows what Lewy body disease is? Raise your hand. Zero. That's about the usual number that knows what Lewy body disease is often referred to as the most common disease that no one's ever heard of. Recently, Robin Williams died. He had dementia. He committed suicide. He had Lewy body disease. One of the sets of symptoms is dementia. Another one is hallucinations. Imagine Robin Williams having hallucinations, right? So you need those diagnoses by people who know what they're doing, right? When Mary and Frank are going to the pharmacy, or especially when just Mary's going because maybe Frank's died or whatever, right? Those folks need to know what they're doing in terms of spotting folks with dementia, making sure in terms of the meds reconciliation that you're not giving somebody that's making all those things worse, right? Actually, in Austria, there was a national program to do just that, just to train all pharmacists and the folks in the front to be dealing with those issues, and if there was an issue that came up, to be alerting the doctors. They said they had tremendous success with this in terms of kind of an early warning system for people going back to the doctors. What about restaurants? Frank and Mary, what do Frank and Mary do on a typical day? They're retired, they've been around for a long time, they spend most of their time at home, they walk around the neighborhood, probably a couple times a week they go out to eat. They're probably going to the same place they've been going out to eat for 30 years. In Marlboro, that's Kennedy's restaurant, right? I don't know where it is in Southboro, but I'll guarantee you folks have been going to the same place for a long time. Or during the day, it's the Dunkin' Donuts, right? So when you're going to the restaurant, do you really want to be presented with a 50-item menu, you know, or have a waitress that's giving you 7 choices, right? In a dementia-friendly restaurant, don't you want someone who actually knows you who's going to say, oh, Mr. Bergeron, today would you like the fish or the chicken? Or even simpler, Mr. Bergeron, the chicken's really good today. How about the chicken, right? So you want a place, and how hard is that, you know, to have a place where the staff is trained to be focusing on this and to be kind of limiting those choices so that you don't have the situation that was also described, I think, by Janice, of going to a restaurant with her, Janice Long, of going to a restaurant with her mother, and the waitress, first of all, you know, she ordered a tuna sandwich, and the waitress came back with a tuna sandwich, and the mother said, oh, no, I didn't order that. And so a big argument ensues between the waitress and the mother. And then finally, you know, Janice says, well, you know, my mother has some memory issues. Oh, well, then from then on in, it was all patronizing. So at the end of the meal, literally the waitress came over, said nothing to the mother, just to the daughter. So, oh, your mother did a great job on that meal. What is that about? You know, in terms of the purpose of that meal was not to eat the tuna sandwich. It was to have this positive experience of going out. So can't restaurants do that? Another interesting, much more positive case. So recently, we've had this woman named Tammy Pozzaricchi come here. She runs a wonderful program in Marlboro called Pleasantries, which is adult day program for folks with early and mid-stage dementia and their caregivers. And so she called over to the Chateau on Route 9 because she said she has about 12 people there typically. She really wanted them to be able to go out and have a nice time. And so she called ahead and said, so what about if we came over, I've got folks here, they all have dementia, and some of them, there'll be a few caregivers, but what about if we came over at like 2 in the afternoon? Well, there's no one there, right? And could you set something up, like we don't want a big menu, you know, a kind of a buffet, just some very straightforward items. And I talked to Tammy. She said, they were wonderful. It was a wonderful time for everybody that was there. The waitresses obviously were trained, and they knew how to be speaking appropriately to the folks with dementia. Everybody walked away just having had a great time. So is that a possibility? And speaking of that, what about actually having a memory cafe, a place where you can go if you are a caregiver or a person with dementia, and relax and have a good time, because you know that a lot of the people there have got memory issues, right? So you don't have to be embarrassed by the fact that you may have a memory issue. I'm old, so I grew up in the 60s. I was in college in the 60s. And so without going into details on this, one of the interesting things I find about people who have kind of earlier mid-stage dementia is you'll be talking to them, and I remember this with my mother. She would start a sentence and kind of get into the middle of the sentence, and she kind of wouldn't know where she was, you know? And so maybe she'd start repeating the sentence, or she would just kind of stop. Well, from having grown up in the 60s, I would suggest that that sounds a lot like a person who's had a little bit of marijuana. So, and if you're a group of people who have had some marijuana, and someone's talking and kind of gets into the middle of the sentence and stops and doesn't know where to go, well, that's very funny. That's actually funny, you know, to the group that's there. If you're married and you're surrounded by a bunch of people who are not comfortable with people with dementia, oh, this is a huge embarrassment. Oh my God, how can this be happening? So Tammy has said that one of the things about her adult day program is that often that one of the things people like about being there is that there are other people who have dementia. So people can joke about this, about not being able to have much of a memory, right? So, and by the way, these memory cafes, Tammy actually created the first one in the state about 4 years ago. There are now dozens of them. The folks at Jewish Family and Children's Services in Waltham, actually it's called Jewish Family and Children's Services of Metro West, if you want to look on their website, of Greater Boston, have actually created a website called The Percolator, in which they are trying to get folks who are running memory cafes or want to do them to connect, so that they can see what other options are, and also so that they can be telling people who have Alzheimer's or who have dementia symptoms and their caregivers that there are a variety of memory cafes in an area, so that literally you could go to a different one every week or every month. And or maybe this cafe, and these cafes typically are in YMCAs or the senior center, or in this case at Tammy's, but what if they were actually at a restaurant? Like this one in Minnesota called J. Arthur's, which is a regular restaurant, but then Saturdays from 2 to 4, they have a memory cafe. And they advertise that, and it's an event, and people come and they come to the memory cafe and they serve food and beer and wine, and sometimes there's music and other things, and they make money, you know, and who else was going to be there on Saturday from 2 to 4 in a restaurant, you know? It's a great time to do it. So just one of the days that they were doing their memory cafe in Minnesota. So it's one of those, it's an easy thing, and it just helps make life more meaningful. What about Frank and Mary going to the grocery store? No matter how bad the dementia, somebody's got to go to the grocery store and get the groceries, right? And it's something they've always done. And they should be able to still go without Mary being worried that she's going to embarrass herself or Frank being worried that his wife's going to get embarrassed. There's a store named the Tesco. It's a food chain, actually, in Chester, England, in the UK, the United Kingdom, where the store manager really has focused on this and training all of his folks to deal with this. He calls it having a store that has mental ramps. You know, he says, you know, remember back before places had ramps, and if you had a wheelchair, you could just never get in, you know, because you could never go up the stairs? And that was considered to be okay. And then society, we all came to agree that because you had a wheelchair, it didn't mean you shouldn't be able to go. Well, similarly, the notion is to have a place, and this is just an example, a store that has mental ramps, where maybe the staff have got more specialized training, right? And so they know how to deal with you. Or maybe there's somebody at the cash register that can help you to make your change. Same thing with other places. What about banks? So when I go to a bank, I find myself often being one of the youngest people there, because very few older or younger people go to banks anymore. Everything is electronic. So a lot of these folks are still going to the bank. And so you need somebody who is there really for two reasons. One, to help them do their transactions. If you've got some dementia issues, this is pretty confusing. But two, to also be kind of spotting if there's something funny. Like, you know, the niece or nephew that you've never seen before at the bank that all of a sudden is becoming the joint owner on the $100,000 CD or the bank account. Or the checks that are getting written out once a week for $1,000 or $2,000. These are problems that I see after the problem has occurred, right? The bank sees them when the problem is occurring, right? So the question, and how many banks do you go to if you're in Southboro? How many bank branches do you go to? So it's a matter of having how many people, 5 banks, 6 banks, all agree that there's going to be some kind of process for helping folks with dementia, and maybe for dealing with or reporting to somebody, maybe the Council on Aging, something that looks like an unusual transaction, something. Actually, there were a chain of banks in New Zealand that did this all the way through the country. There were 17 banks that all focused on getting their folks to become dementia friendly. Interesting, I read about this, and they said that the person who owns the chain had all of his managers get together. And at the beginning of the meeting, asked them, so has anybody here had an experience with family with dementia? Well, 15 out of 17 did. The great thing about doing this stuff is that once you're really talking about it, you find out how many people are really touched by this. My goal would really be, in my world, that all of these places would have a little sticker on the outside, Frank and Mary, welcome here. Frank and Mary, welcome here. Same issue applies in the mall, where folks are going all the time. But especially in public spaces, at the park. Now, the park is some place where Frank and Mary can go anytime. Well, not anytime, not today with 6 inches of snow in April, right? But a lot, right? And it's a place that is a public place where some very basic things can make this very attractive. There needs to be a flat surface. There needs to be, because Frank and Mary may be having some trouble walking as this goes along with dementia. Ideally, there are bathrooms, but mainly you have unobstructed views. So you have a place where Mary's not going to get lost, and somebody's not going to be able to find her, right? So there are a set of things, but these are things you can think out. That's what Seattle did. If you go to the Seattle Parks Department website, there's a whole section on their dementia-friendly programs. They do walk. They've done some design things in their parks. They also do walks. Think of the memory cafe, but you're outside, you know? So there's the regular times in parks that are appropriate where you can just get outside. A great thing for Frank and Mary to do. not a hard thing for the community to do. Once again, think about how that applies in the library. In a dementia-friendly community, shouldn't there be a set of books that Frank can go read? Some easy way that Frank can kind of learn about all this stuff, right? Shouldn't museums have the same kind of adaptation? What's the role of the senior center? Well, it can be pretty much what you want. It can probably be doing some of the things that senior centers are now doing, having day programs, having exercise programs, having a bunch of things. A number of senior centers actually run these memory cafes, right? They should be there to provide that kind of caregiver support so that there's a place where Frank and others can get together and talk this stuff out, right? And maybe they're the ones that need to be really coordinating with the parks, with the bank, with a whole bunch of the players around making sure that folks in Southboro with dementia are safe. What about the role of the assisted living community? So the interesting thing about assisted living, so the way they've evolved over the last several years, or really over the last 20 years, is that increasingly they have memory care communities within them. And I'm thinking of the very large one in Marlborough, New Horizons, which has the Hearthstone program within it, run by a guy named John Zeisel, who is actually a nationally known leader in terms of care for folks who have dementia. So the folks in that memory care unit, what are they doing all day? They are working with the folks who are living in that community, dealing with these issues all the time, three shifts a day. And at the end of every shift, the staff are getting together and saying, so what happened today? So what happened with Mary? Oh, she had this incident, you know, and we had talked to her about at breakfast and things went really bad. And so now the other staff are suggesting, how could you have done that better? So assisted livings actually have this pool of trained people. They are the ideal place to be learning about, for Frank and others, to be learning about how to deal with folks with dementia. They're also, in terms of the business model of the assisted livings, they want to be doing that work because they want you to know, if you're Frank and Mary and you don't want to live at home anymore, that you can come live there. So the assisted livings, and we have a lot of them around here, and many of them have memory care. That one does, the Beaumonts do, but I know the Beaumont in Northboro has a memory care unit. So easy ways of using the skill sets that you already have here. And finally, what about the nursing home in a dementia-friendly community? Oh my God, the reason why my clients come to me, don't ever send me to a nursing home. More spouses, including my father, have been guilted out by their spouse saying, don't promise me, you're never going to send me to the nursing home. And finally, their physical or mental condition is such that they need to go to the nursing home, right? Now, there are a couple of reasons why when I say the word nursing home, you just shudder and say, oh my God, I'll never do it, I'll shoot myself, whatever. That relates, I would suggest, to the nursing homes themselves. Now, one of the issues with nursing homes is that there are several. They're big, they're institutional, and they got no money. Now, I feel partially responsible for the no money part, because we've done seminars here in which I've explained to people how you can always qualify for MassHealth. And a lot of people do. And as a result, in most nursing homes, 75 to 80% of the beds are occupied by people who are on MassHealth. And MassHealth pays crummy. So the nursing homes have very little money with which to provide programs and things. So in a dementia-friendly community, maybe we're helping that. Maybe we in the community are helping to provide programs in that nursing home. Because the nursing home won't, because they don't have the money. Or because they're too cheap sometimes, because they're for profit, you know. So maybe we need to be bringing in programs or just pictures on the wall. And mainly we need, in a dementia-friendly community, to feel that if someone needs to go to a nursing home, they haven't, like, you know, passed over this moat. And now they're this other place, you know, and you've kind of waved goodbye. Goodbye. We'll see you at the funeral. We'll never see you again now. Because we don't want to think about it. We don't want to think about it. So maybe in a dementia-friendly community is a different relationship. And maybe in the long run, the nursing home itself is different. There's a national model called the greenhouse model for nursing homes of the future, which typically do not have 100 beds, but have 20. And typically each individual is in a single, and it's built around a central facility, which is typically a dining facility and and the folks with dementia, typically mostly women, are encouraged to participate in meal preparation and cleaning up and stuff, because for that generation, that's what they did a lot, right? When they were growing up, all stuff they can still do. Now, that model is going to cost more money than the current nursing homes. But it's not, but it isn't that to do that model, you need to generate all the money, just enough money to get you from where the nursing home is to where that nursing home could be, because Medicare and Medicaid are going to be paying for a lot of the other stuff. You just have to get to that next level. Now, all of the things that I talked about. Oh, excuse me, one other thing. What about Frank? In this world, what about Frank? Because Frank is the key to Mary's happiness here, as long as Frank is around. So Frank needs education. How do I talk to my wife now that she doesn't know my name? How do I get overcome some of that irritation, you know, or the fact that she's repeating herself all the time? How do I talk to my wife, right? He needs some support. He needs a support group. He needs friends in the neighborhood, and he needs a life. He needs the ability sometimes to just be able to get out. We need to be able to give Frank that, right? A lot of us do. So all of these things are going to require money. There's training, there's facility, there's programs. It's all going to require money. And so the question is going to be, where does the money come from? There are three possibilities. There is the sky. We could pray for this money, and it will come out of the sky. Oh, I hope we had some money, right? And that might work. Or that way, in the old religious, you know, you pray to God, and God would provide you with money. In the more kind of secular world, you pray to Bill Gates. Maybe Bill Gates will send us $1 million to Southboro, Mass., right? Or maybe the federal government will. Maybe Uncle Sam will produce a lot of money. Maybe Uncle Bernie will. Uncle Donald, I doubt. You know, I don't think in any case we should be counting on these outside sources to be doing this. And that's the key to a dementia-friendly community. It's going to have to come from here. You're going to have to come to believe that there are things that are important. There is enough money in Southboro for Southboro to be a dementia-friendly community, so that every one of you who is here or watching this can know that no matter how old you get, no matter how confused you get, you can still live happily in Southboro. There's enough money to do that. The question is, do you have the political will to do it, right? Because the money will come. If it is a good idea, money follows good ideas. The question is not, is there money? The question is, are the ideas right? So what is happening now in Marlboro, Hudson, and Northboro is that each one of these communities has actually created a group that is trying to figure out how they can become dementia-friendly. One of the things that we felt, we realized that Minnesota was not doing right was they were asking these volunteers to just operate totally as volunteers. We realized coming back that you need staff to make these things go and keep moving smoothly. So when we came back, Christine Alessandro from Bay Path got a grant from the Metro West Health Foundation to provide staff to help these things go. And we hired somebody, and that's Cindy Cormier, who is here, and is going to talk to you a little bit about how that is happening in those three communities. Cindy.
Thank you. Good afternoon. As Arthur mentioned, I'm Cindy Cormier, and I'm working for Bay Path Elder Services. Most of you know me as Arthur's sidekick that sets up the equipment, but he's talked me into a new job now, an additional job, I should say. Dementia-friendly communities, we're calling it Come to Be Dementia-Friendly, and it's something that we're doing in Hudson, Marlboro, and Northboro. Reason being is because those three towns are close to each other, and Marlboro is a city, and Hudson's are more rural, and Northboro's a little bit more affluent, and so we're doing it in those towns. This is a grassroots effort. It's not a Bay Path effort, and it's not a senior center effort. It's something that the community is doing for the community that they live in, and we're using the Act on Alzheimer's Toolkit. You'll see in your package there, the website is there. Minnesota has developed a toolkit that contains everything we need to understand what the needs are in a community and to act on that. If you go in on that website, there's a lot of information. One, I think that piece that I think is useful to kind of get an idea of what it is that we're talking about, there's a list there of the local communities in Minnesota. I think they implemented 38 communities so far, and it shows those different communities and what it is that they actually implemented. So you get a better idea of what's the outcome of this program. And of course, the whole goal is to create an environment that's safe and a happy environment for folks that have dementia. Arthur talked about dementia-friendly communities. Basically, he's gone through a lot of the different sectors and how that would be affected. Another one is in the religious organizations. We've heard of a situation where someone was asked not to come to church because they were disruptive in the church. That's kind of sad. And maybe we should be looking for a place where folks could go for fellowship and music, because that's really what they want out of the situation. Maybe something like the kids' mass, you know, where it's not so intense and they don't have to worry about being disturbed. As I mentioned, it's Hudson, Marlboro, and Northboro. The total population in 2010 was a little over, almost 72,000 folks. And the number of people over the age of 65 was close to 10,000. And of that, 1 in 9 folks over the age of 65 have dementia. So that brings our total in 2010 up to a little over 1,000. Those numbers are from 2010. The numbers obviously have grown. And also, I think that the numbers are much higher because I think there's a lot of folks that haven't been officially diagnosed with dementia. So there's a real need in our community. The toolkit that I mentioned from Act on Alzheimer's out in Minnesota is a four-phase process. We're currently in the first phase in those three communities. It's the convene phase. That's where we utilize the ability of the senior centers of the Council on Aging to reach out to their communities to bring folks in to learn about what this process is and what the goal of this process is. And so we have got to the point where we've had community meetings. We now have action teams. Those action teams, in fact, tomorrow is Northboro's second action team, and Marlboro and Hudson will follow soon after that. So those folks, the action teams are made up of folks from all different walks of life. We have fire, police, library. We have Walgreens, Hudson. Marlboro has 2 Walgreens and Hudson has 1. We have representatives from all 3 of them to participate. We have healthcare workers. We have caregivers. The one thing that we don't have that we would really like to have, but it's difficult, is somebody that actually has early stage dementia to kind of monitor what we're doing and give us some sense of whether they feel like it's something that's cool or not. Now that we have these teams together, we're going to move into the next phase, which is assess. In the toolkit, there's 11 different surveys. They're based on the different sectors. So there's one for healthcare, there's one for caregivers, et cetera, et cetera. So we'll take those surveys and we will create a subgroup within those action teams that will actually go out and sit with folks in those different areas and survey them. The surveys have, 10 to 20 questions on them. So we'll sit down with a person and go through that survey. So it might be a healthcare worker. And, do you have any experience with Alzheimer's? What do you know about Alzheimer's? Do you have folks that come in with Alzheimer's, with dementia? Do you feel like there's training available to you? Those kinds of things to understand where the holes are and where we can have some opportunities. Once those surveys are done, then they're going to go back to BayPath, and BayPath will actually tally up the results of those surveys. The toolkit includes a tool for doing that. When they do that, then they'll pass those results, obviously, onto the action teams in each of the communities. That's where the action team will see what's the need. What are the needs? Those needs may be different for each community, depending on what they have already or what they need. And then, of course, the fourth phase is to act on those. So whatever it is, whether it just be education, sensitivity training, that type of thing, materials. I know that there's a good document out there around how to deal with somebody with Alzheimer's. Arthur's mentioned you don't keep asking them questions because that's getting you nowhere. But there's specific tricks to dealing with folks with Alzheimer's. These are some resources. That's the website for the Act on Alzheimer's program. As I mentioned, they've already done 38 communities, and they've done some great work. You might want to check that out. Dementia Friendly America, that's another effort that's going on at a little bit higher level, which Minnesota folks are part of and we're becoming part of. And then, of course, the Alzheimer's Association, which always has a lot of reference materials. There's some contact information, Janice, Tricia, and Kelly from the three different Council on Agings. They'd be happy to answer any questions. And my phone, my email address is there. So feel free, if you have any interest, give me a buzz.
Thank you, Cindy.
And that's the Marlboro team.
That's the Marlboro team. That's me on the left, so I'm participating. And that's the goal. The goal is that Frank and Mary can just stay at home until they die, no matter how confused they get. Not a bad goal, I would suggest. So thank you very much for coming. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact us. I know that the folks at BayPath Elder Services are interested in seeing whether there are additional communities that want to do this once they've gone through the process in Marlboro, Hudson, and Northboro, which should be completed later on this year. Thank you very much. And we will see you at the next seminar, which will really be more like a seminar. Thank you.
You're very good at what you do.
So, thank you for coming.
Thank you.